Till I meet my end. Welcome to the 29th Annual Chicago Tribune Printers Row Lit Fest. I want to give a special thanks to all the sponsors out there in the crowd. Without you guys, this would not be possible. Judy Blume's books will be sold in the rotunda right out there, and then she will be signing here at the end of the program. I will be explaining more at the end of the program as well to give you more explicit instructions. Please keep the spirit of the Lit Fest going all year with a subscription to Printers Row, the Tribune's premium book section, fiction series, and the membership program. Visit the Printers Row Welcome Center at Harrison and Dearborn for special Lit Fest subscription rates and perks, including Lit Fest tote bags and posters. Before we begin today's program, please turn off your cell phone and all other electronics. And then please welcome Gerald Kern, Senior Vice President and Editor of the Chicago Tribune.
Thank you and welcome everyone. I'm so glad that you've come to Lit Fest. I think the last 2 days have been fantastic and I hope you've enjoyed it as much as I have. Especially for this event today, which is special to us. When Judy Blume was a young girl growing up in New Jersey, she would spend much of her time during the day imagining stories about people, places, and situations that crisscrossed her world. As she tells this story, Blume was a daydreamer who made up stories while I bounced the ball against the side of the house, and I made them up while I practiced the piano, but I never wrote them down, and I never told anyone about them. Her reveries ultimately would lead her to pen and paper, and she would indeed write them down. Blume began writing while her children were in preschool, and she was drawn to the situations that confronted children and young adults. But little did she know when she was that imaginative young girl young writer that she would revolutionize a genre and touch off a cultural battle that played out during the 1970s and 1980s. And as a result, Blume became a fierce opponent of censorship and an author recognized around the world for her courage. And therefore, the Chicago Tribune is honored to present Judy Blume with the 2013 Young Adult Literary Prize. Blume joins a distinguished roster of other Tribune Young Literary Award winners, and these have included Neil Gaiman, Walter Dean Myers, Lois Lowry, Joan Bauer, and others. Now, with a special gift for channeling universal anxieties, fears, and frustrations of preteens, Blume took on subjects that others would not touch. And she did it with an uncanny ear for dialogue, an instinct for hearing that was what was unsaid. In Are You There, God? It's Me, Margaret, Blume writes about a 12-year-old girl who confronts all the mysterious and difficult changes facing a preteen girl as she transitions to young womanhood, menstruation, buying a first bra, sexual awakenings. And in Deanie, and in Then Again I Won't, she explored other uncomfortable subjects that often accompany adolescence, subjects such as masturbation. She took on bullying and was one of the first to do it in Blubber, focusing on an overweight and awkward girl tormented by cruel classmates. Blume confronted those conflicts and crises in a manner that was so honest that her young readers believed that someone, perhaps for the first time, really understood them. They adored her for speaking directly to them. But the reaction of some adults, including some of those young readers' parents, was not so adoring. Judy Blume was a threat, they said, to a writer who is trying to undermine the morals of their children. In the early 1980s, the forces of censorship mobilized, challenges to books soared, battle lines were drawn in some schools, and in others, books quietly disappeared from the shelves as teachers and school administrators sought to avoid controversy altogether. Judy Blume fought against all those who sought to remove her books, but she went beyond that. She also waged a vigorous battle on behalf of all writers and all readers. And in the end, Blume's books prevailed because of their substance, their depth, and truth, and because more people care about freedom of expression than fear it. Now, her books have sold 82 million copies and have been translated into 32 languages, and they are helping young adults come of age all over the world. After her success in young adult literature, Blume pushed into new territory with adult novels such as Wifey and Smart Women, and both shot to the top of the New York Times bestseller list. Today, she's not only working on a new novel, but in collaboration with her son, Lawrence, on a movie adaptation of her book, Tiger Eyes, which opened this last Friday in Chicago. Now, Judy Blume will be interviewed today by our friend, Julia Keller, a longtime cultural critic for the Chicago Tribune and the winner of the Pulitzer Prize in feature writing. Julia is a regular contributor to Printers Row, our weekly literary journal. She's also an accomplished fiction writer of her own, and she's the author of a critically acclaimed novel, A Killing in the Hills, the first in a mystery series set in her native West Virginia. Julia is now a professor at Ohio University, where she teaches writing. So we want to present our Young Adult Literature Award to Judy Blume, so please join me in welcoming Judy Blume to the stage.
Thank you so much.
We want to present this to you, and very honored to have done so, and so admire your work.
I am so honored. I'm so honored. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, guys. Thank you so much. Thank you. I just have to tell you that, and Julia, when I started to write, of course, I've been around so long, there was no YA category when I was writing, so I've never thought of myself as a YA author. And then YA turned up. Sorry, I have laryngitis. And then I remember the death of the YA novel. I remember when, people were saying, this is it, the death of the YA novel. I still didn't think of myself as ever having written YA novels, maybe forever, but that was published before the category existed. So I'm happy for all my friends who do write YA novels that it's going so well for them, but I still don't think of myself that way, but I so appreciate this award. And I have to tell you, the generous monetary honorarium that comes along with this, I will be donating to the National Coalition Against Censorship. And I want to tell you why, even. And that is because, just let me clear my throat, I'm sorry. Wow. Last week I was in LA and I totally lost my voice. It was like nothing. So I'm doing a lot better this week. But yesterday, at a screening of Tiger Eyes, I met six young women, middle school students in Glen Ellen, I think. And anybody here from Glen Ellen?
All right.
And the school board there wants to remove the perks of being a wallflower from this middle school, from the school system. And these kids, they are fighting the good fight. They want their book. They are making a video. They've made a video. And they came to the screening and they asked me to say something in 6 seconds or less. why this book needs to be, George, my husband's there. What is the key word?
Keep the book alive.
Keep the book alive. And so when they present their case on Monday night, there will be this little 6 second video from me on their main video that says, keep the book alive. And they're working. And these kids on their own, or they have parents and they have teachers behind them, and they got to National Coalition Against Censorship and the group that works with schools and libraries to keep the book alive. I only wish Judith Krug were alive and here today, because she would know what to do.
Very good, very good. Well, first, welcome to Chicago.
Thank you.
I have to say that of all the people that, you know, working with the Tribune, the perk for me was I get to meet people like E.L. Doctorow and Joyce Carol Oates and Margaret Atwood. And I was telling Judy, and this is the absolute truth, that of all these famous writers, Salman Rushdie, who have trod these boards here, saying the name, no name has evoked the reaction as when people say, so who are you talking to at LitFest? Judy Blume. A light comes into the eyes, any age, both genders, goes across every socioeconomic divide. A lift comes into the shoulders, people stand a little taller, and they say reverently, Judy Blume. And I'm sure you all know what I'm talking about. There was a little girl crossing the street, we were on our way here, and she was chanting it, Judy Blume. Judy Blume. I mean, it really, of course, it's a lovely name. It has its own lilting assonance as well. But it also speaks to this tremendous, and really, it's quite fitting, actually, we would have a baby crying.
We have a new reader. We're getting ready for the new readers.
Absolutely. And I wanted to start out asking you about Tiger Eyes, which is a project I know that you're thrilled about. And you worked with your son. Now, for most of us, working with a parent usually means like a project outside in the yard. But I think this is something quite different. Can you tell us a little bit what that is, those who don't know of it yet?
Yeah, well, my son is a grown man, and he's been in the film business for a long time. And he read Tiger Eyes for the first time when he was 18 and going off to college, but knowing that he wanted to, learn how to make films. And we lived in northern New Mexico at the time. And when I wrote the book, and he said, someday I'm going to make this into a movie. And as he would tell you, it only took 31 years.
Yeah.
And what happened was somebody approached him with a small budget, but enough of a budget to do an indie film based on the book. And we've always said if we could get the chance to work together, Tiger Eyes was the one that we would adapt for the screen. So, we didn't have to sit around and think about it. It was like, do you want to do it? Is this the right time? Yes, this is the right time.
So what was it like? I mean, the book and the film is normally kind of a fraught experience in itself. To be working with someone you love and care about, to see this different medium, what was it like for you as an author to see this, your story explored in an entirely different way?
Well, we worked together from day one. We wrote the screenplay together. Ah. So, I can't really blame anybody for taking my work and ruining it. I have to take part of that credit myself. And we were co-producers. I mean, there were other producers, too, including my husband, who saved us with his executive producing on more than one occasion. So we had the screenplay, and we went to New Mexico, and we cast the movie together. And we had three and a half days to cast the whole movie. Mm. I could tell you a lot about it, but I know we have to talk about other things. And it was, and I think that we were both mature enough at this stage of life to separate the mother-son relationship. We've always called each other Judy Larry anyway. He's called me Judy since he went off to college. And that's fine. And on the set, we were co-producers. He's the director. Director's king on the set. I know my place, but he welcomed me, and not every director wants the writer of the original material, which I have been called before, around the set. So, I was there every day. It was probably the most thrilling experience of my professional life.
Really?
Oh,
really?
Yes, I loved it. I loved it.
What was it about seeing, because the words on a page for you, presumably there is, in effect, a movie already in your head, when you're writing. You're seeing your scenes unfold. So what was it about seeing it outside of yourself, as it were, that was really exhilarating for you? I mean, I can hear how exhilarating it was.
It was the collaborative spirit. It was, all these people working together. We had only 23 days, so it was fast. And it went from sun up to long after sundown. And you never knew what was going to happen every day. And that's like writing, because you never know what's going to happen. You know, but it's only you when you don't know what's going to happen on the set. Will it go? Will we be able to get that scene? Because there was no money to do it over. You know, when you're writing, you can sit there as long as you want and scribble, 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 which I do. So it was very different and very exciting, very exciting.
And you relish the new challenge. Sounds like you really.
I love new challenges, and
embrace
I did
this.
Love
yes.
it. Yes, I did love it.
You know, something I've always wanted to ask you is there something about what we read when young? Is it kind of like imprinting on a baby duck or something that when you read it? It seems like when you read something when you're young, you carry it with you forever. Now, as an adult, we read books that we love, of course, but there's something about the books we read, and I think that speaks to the chant that I heard, you know, throughout LitFest, Judy Blume, Judy Blume. So, and I'm wondering, is there, what is it about the books we read when young? Are we more receptive? Are we more open?
You know, these are things, it's hard for me to try to figure it out because it's dangerous. You know, then I would never, I'd be afraid to go into that little room and try to write again.
Yes.
But I think what it is I represent, I don't know, so many of your childhoods. You know, people who come up to me at book signings, I'm part of their childhoods.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's a very nostalgic thing. I have the most loyal readers in the entire world.
It is. Yeah, it is. I know what you mean about not wanting to analyze it. It's like the old story about the person asked the centipede, well, how do you do it with all those legs? How do you? And after that, he can't move.
Right. So. Exactly.
You don't want that.
Exactly. No. So, you know, Larry, my son, calls me the least analytical person he's ever met. And that may be true.
Right, right.
And he analyzes. For good reason. I don't. I'm, you know, instinct. Natural, whatever comes, comes.
So how did you, there you are, a young woman, a couple of kids, how did you ever get the audacity to think that the things you cared about and wanted to write about would move the world, would move others? Where did the gall come?
I never thought that.
Did you not?
I was the creative kid in school.
Yeah.
I grew up, I loved school, I loved all those creative outlets, you know,
right.
And suddenly, I'm in suburban New Jersey, and I'm a young wife and mother of two by the time I'm 25. Mm-hmm. And I loved baby care. I still like baby care. Where's that baby? Just bring that baby up here. I connect with babies. I really like babies. But I was missing something. I was sick all the time through my 20s.
Mm.
And I just needed to do something. And I don't know, writing, maybe it could have been anything. But, you know, we stayed at home then with
mm-hmm.
our children, and I just started, you know, rhyming picture books while I was
mm-hmm.
washing the dishes in the evening after dinner. And I tried that for a little while, and that didn't work so well. And I thought, I mean, I did think what I really love to read is I love to read fiction. I love to read novels.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe I'll try to write one of those.
Right, right. So it was really just that simple, just saying this is just not with this grandiose
really
plan.
It was really that simple.
To go about it.
It was that simple. And I tell people, like, how do you find out how to write? How do you learn how to write? Because you read. You're a reader. You read, read, read. It's like movies, you know? I was a moviegoer. My parents took me to the movies always.
Mm-hmm.
To them, reading was a great thing. What I read at home was never restricted. We had shelves of books, and that was good. You know, Judy liked to be around on the floor and pull the books down. You know, so.
I've read, you know, I think that's a common thing. I remember reading about a lot of authors who said that they had unrestricted access to reading when they were young. There's something about that. There's something about being told that you have this great, great smorgasbord of literature out there. Go satisfy yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And you probably, I'm guessing, but maybe you read just a little above yourself. So you were challenging yourself. I mean, you read what you were supposed to. Yeah. Okay. I sense that.
Well, by the time I was 12, you know, I mean, well, there were no YA books.
Right, right.
There was somebody, Barton, Nurse. What was that? No, not
no,
Sarah. Susie? No, not Clara.
Cherry Ames was, Ames, Nurse Cherry Ames.
Yes, there was Cherry Ames, yeah. And there was somebody nurse, and we read those books.
Yes.
I remember very clearly reading 17th Summer. 17th
yes.
Summer really spoke to me. When,
yes.
When we were 15, we all read 17th Summer.
A little bit above, yes, yes.
Well, it wasn't really above, but it was...
No, I mean, age-wise, you know, that you're wanting
yeah,
to read...
Yeah, but that, I mean, the books I was reading in my parents' bookshelves, I was reading The Adventures of Augie March. You know, Saul Bellow. I was reading just lots and lots of great books like that. And I may not have understood everything in them, but I was so curious about the world of adults. Nobody really told me anything. And I was, you know, deeply curious. And I was satisfied reading a lot of those books.
That intellectual curiosity, you know, people ask me about teaching now, and that's the one thing I don't see in my students, and it's really... troublesome to me, that intellectual, the very thing you're talking about, just the, I don't really care what you know or don't know, I just want you to be curious enough to go out and find it. I mean, we all have pockets of ignorance and pockets of knowledge, but that reaching, am I just an old fuddy-duddy, or do you see any difference in kids today? Are they not as curious?
I don't know.
Uh-oh, because you're calling me a fuddy-duddy. I can see it in your eyes. There just seems to be, is there a difference now? Do you see the generation that's coming to you now? I mean, you're a perfect person to talk about generational span of readers. You have readers who are 12 and readers who are in their 70s and 80s, and you have and everything in between. Is there a difference in kids today?
Everybody asks me that. Is there a difference in kids today?
And so answer it.
I don't know. I mean, this is what I do know. I do know that feelings and what's deep inside you does not change from generation to generation. I know that. Outside, you know, electronics change, the way they're spending their time changes because of all these electronics that are available to them. There are still readers. There are still kids who love to read, you know that, and who still want to read real life stories. And I don't knock dystopian, you know, fiction or werewolves or vampires or anything. And whatever gets kids excited about reading, this is good. This is good. Let them read it and hope that they move on. I mean, I might have been excited about that when I was young. I loved the Oz books when I was like 9. You know, but there are still kids who want very much to read about reality.
The real life.
That's all I can write about. That's what I know about. That's what I care about. I'm never going to be able to write fantasy.
Right. No, I think you're right. Actually, you fell right into my trap, because that was exactly what I was going to say about, we think of the great writers who have persisted. I mean, we don't live in a world that is at all like Shakespeare's world. We still read Shakespeare. Things have changed in the world since you began writing.
Yeah.
And of course, you've kept writing all along. But the essentials are still there, just as you say, the feelings and the scare. My favorite book of yours is otherwise known as Sheila the Great. That's my favorite. Anybody else's favorite? Is that anybody? Yeah. What a book. Somebody who's scared.
It's not my favorite.
It's not your...
I'm glad you like it. No, I'm glad you like
now
it.
Now you know we did not plan this beforehand. It's totally spontaneous. I love the fact that she's scared and won't admit it, and she's, you know, kind of a show off with the secret core of fear, and there's just so much about it. And I was rereading a lot of your book story, you know, in advance of this, and I was amazed. I shouldn't have been amazed, but to say that they hold up is condescending, because it's more than hold up. They still reflect reality in this completely authentic and utterly delightful and surprising way.
Thank you.
That's what I guess I was unprepared for. I thought, yeah, Judy Blume, whatever. And yet, the books really do. And even the younger grade books, the Fudge books, of course. Now, is Fudge your son? Is
yes.
Fudge based on...
Well,
okay.
Yes. I mean, he was the inspiration. And he stands there and accepts it, especially when we're talking to an audience with a lot of children in
yes.
it. You know, I have to tell them. He's big, you know.
Right. So,
and so I say, he was the original inspiration, but then Fudge took on his own life.
Right.
And Sally Free, not Sally, I'm sorry, getting to the other one. Sheila. Sheila has all of my childhood fears. I was a very, very fearful child.
Yeah.
Anxious child. Eczema. And
Oh, really? Did you have her kind of bravado?
No.
Not at all, okay.
No.
Right.
No, I didn't have her bravado. No.
That was the thing. And the whole swimming scene. Do you remember the whole when she's learning to swim?
I can do that. Oh.
Yeah,
I can
exactly
do that,
right.
But I have a cough today.
You're exactly right. The million and one excuses. And the, like, oh, haven't we been there?
Right.
It's really. All right, so
Sheila.
Now.
I like Sheila.
See there? I turned her around on her own character. What is your favorite book? You knew this was coming.
Yeah, but I can't answer that question. But I mean, I did. You heard what word came out. Sally Friedman came out.
Yes, we did.
Sally. I mean, Sally Friedman is my most autobiographical book.
Really?
I mean, she's the kind of kid I was. And I wrote, you know what was the inspiration for writing that book? I got a letter from a teacher somewhere, I don't even remember where anymore. And she was doing a study over the summer of creative people in creative fields. And what were they like as children? And I thought that was really interesting. And so, you know, thinking back to my own childhood, all those stories that you just heard about me bouncing the ball and inventing stories inside my head, but never sharing them, never telling anyone, because that would make me so weird, I thought. I would be such a weird kid who had stories inside her head, so I never told anybody.
Mm-hmm.
No friends, no teachers, no parents. Nobody knew what I was doing. My mother used to tell people, Judy can play so nicely by herself. She didn't know I wasn't really by myself.
You must get a ton of letters from kids. And over the years, now that email has made it a little bit easier, I can only imagine. Like your post office must hate you, right? First of all, then.
No. Well, I mean, of course, being able to send email has changed that completely. But email is fun because it's so immediate.
Mm.
You know, I'm not sure that I get as many letters that kids would write when they took the pencil and they wrote in longhand and they spilled their guts out.
And they did.
And then they mailed it off, and it was like, I'm done with that. I don't know this person. You know, I don't have to sit with this person tomorrow morning at breakfast.
Mm-hmm.
And there's less of that now. They may also have more places to go, you know, for answers to their questions. I still get them, but not as many. And some people will write them and send them in an email.
You must have gotten some over the years that are incredibly heartbreaking, too. I mean, that when you read, people tell you things they wouldn't tell others, just as you said. They wouldn't tell their parents, might not tell their best friend. That must have been, I mean, you really became the repository for a lot of people's, certainly their joys, but also their sorrows.
Yeah.
How did you, still. Was there a way you were able to deal
At
with it?
At one point, I had to go to a therapist to find out.
For other
out.
People's problems.
Yeah.
Yeah.
To find out how, because I'm not trained. You know, I'm not a mandated reporter, although I took that very seriously and felt that I had to. But I went to a therapist to say, help me, help them.
Yeah.
I was getting deeply involved. I was so, so involved in some children's lives that I couldn't write.
Yeah, it would be paralyzing.
I just couldn't do it. And at one point, you know, I did collect a lot of their letters and put it in a book. Letters to Judy, what kids wish they could tell you.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
But just in
and
terms of your own.
She helped me. She said, you know, you cannot save all the kids who are writing to you who need saving. So just, you know, be supportive. Be a supportive friend to them if you can through letters. And that's all you can do.
Right, right. Now, have things changed for you over the years in terms of just your writing regimen? I mean, you're no longer a young mother with two kids, so
I'm not.
What's
it's been a long time.
But you want that baby in the audience. I saw your eyes light up.
I like those babies.
So what? How is it different for you now? You sit down. You're in the midst of another work. So is it? I mean, I'm assuming that the outside particulars have changed, but has the internal?
No, it changed? Hasn't. It hasn't. And when I was that young mother. Writing when they were at school, I used to say to myself, someday, you know, when they're older, oh, I'll just be able to write so much because I won't be restricted, you know, won't have to stop at 3 o'clock in the afternoon when they come home from school. And in fact, it's just the opposite.
Yeah.
It's just the opposite. I'm free, and yet there's so much to do. And it's harder. It's harder. But the regimen is the same. I mean, if I don't get into the little room in the morning, it's not going to happen. And I am in the middle of writing a book, which I stopped for these months for promoting the movie. But it has to happen in the morning, or it's not going to happen that day. My morning toilet takes longer and longer. I don't know why that is. I don't know. I mean, I don't put on makeup or do anything. It just takes so long to get in there. I used to get them off to school, and bingo, I was at the typewriter.
Right away.
Yeah.
You know, I was interested in your comments about YA. I mean, one thing we do when we have a genre, when suddenly something gets stamped with a genre, it's both bad and good. You know, we tend to put things, we try to stuff them into categories, and I know booksellers like that, but
I hate it.
It's I get the sense that it's not something you think has been particularly good for.
Well,
literature.
I think it's very good for my friends who have been successful writing YA. For me, I don't want any part of it. I don't want to write a YA book. I don't think I'd even know how. The novel I'm writing now, which my husband calls an historical novel, hit him over the head, because it takes place in the 50s when I was growing up. And I, you know, looking back, I always told myself I hate this decade. I hate the 50s. It was so bland. I mean, the child, I'm talking about me now, when I look back, the child part of me I find interesting is up to age 12. And then, wanting to be like everybody else, you know, wanting to fit in. Maybe that's always true. Maybe that's always going to be true. But this book that takes place in the 50s when I was a teenager, and there are a lot of teenage voices in it. There are three main characters. They are teenagers, but it's really based on something that happened in my hometown of Elizabeth, New Jersey, when I was a kid that I would rather not talk about now, but it was real. And I had to do the research, even though I have a really good memory, even at 75, I have a really good memory. Not for where my keys are or my sunglasses, but I never had a good memory for those things anyway, but for events and feelings.
Right.
But I did research, and I did this research, and I thought this was the most fun I've ever had. And I told all my friends, including my husband, who are nonfiction writers, and they all said, oh, yeah, 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 but wait till you have to sit down and write the book. The research is so much fun. I can't imagine ever writing another novel without doing research. I loved it.
Really liked it.
And I have a huge notebook. And it's great to have it there. It's great to have it there. But everything else is fiction.
Right.
You know, the families are fiction. And the first draft was torture, the way it always is. But I got to tell you, I'm almost finished with the second draft. I don't show it to anybody till I'm finished with the third draft. No agent, no editor, no husband, nobody. He knows because he listens to me talking about it all the time.
Right. About the and he probably sneaks in when you're not around.
No, he doesn't do that. He doesn't do that. But I've got three huge notebooks, you know.
Yeah.
Research, first draft. And what made me do these notebooks? I know you want to know this. Why did I get organized? Because this is new. Because Summer Sisters almost killed me. Seriously, and it was 3 years and 20-something drafts. And I had boxes and boxes of drafts. And there was no organization to them. And I got lost while I was writing this book. I got so lost. So now, and I think this is a good trick for anybody who writes, I'm happy to share it with you. I print out on three-hole paper. And I do, and I'm trying to go back to where I was when it was typewriters, and you did a draft, and then you did another draft, and then you did another draft, and then you sent it to your editor, and you worked with your editor, and you did a fourth, and then a polish, a fifth, and then you were done. That's how it worked with a typewriter. So I'm trying to get back to that with a computer. Mm-hmm. And I think printing out on three-hole paper and putting it into a notebook, first draft, second draft, and I'm almost done with the second draft, and then there'll be a third draft. And yes, my most creative stuff still comes with a pencil on the printout. I waste paper, I'm sorry, but I try to do those slides. And that is really, really helping me write this book that's, it's like Summer Sisters, kind of all over the place. A lot of characters, a lot going on. I don't know yet who the audience is. Mm. I don't know. I don't want to think about that.
When you were talking there, I was remembering an old line I heard, which is, research is endlessly seductive, writing is hard work. And I thought, that's it. Judy Blume has just described it.
Research is, yes, it was so much fun.
It is fun, isn't it? Right. We only felt that way during college, right? I want to make, I know the audience is like absolutely itching to get involved in this conversation too.
Good.
So we have two people with microphones who are going to be roving about. So if you have a question for Judy, raise your hand. If you could, let the mic come to you. We want to make sure that she can hear your question and then everyone else can too. So if you want to raise your hand.
Ask me anything.
All right. She says, ask her anything. There we go. Over here.
Hello. I was looking on Fandango to see where your movie's playing. And it's playing in just one theater.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you. So talk right into the mic. Is the mic on?
Is it on?
Go ahead. We'll repeat it if we can't. Go ahead. She's looking for your film on, she was looking on Fandango for Tiger Eyes.
Oh. And I see it's playing in Rosemont in one theater. And yesterday I went looking for movies. There's a lot of junk out right now. I mean, you know, summertime. But why just one theater? What is with the film industry? Why small movies don't get larger distribution?
They don't get wide releases. Well, this is a long story that my husband could answer better than I can. But while we got the funding to make the movie, because that came to us, really most distributors were not at all interested in distributing the movie. They did not know who to market it to. And in today's world, it's a business and it's all about marketing. So, like my books, it's who do you market it to? Do you market it to a teenage audience? I don't want to restrict it to a teenage audience. Do you market it to the nostalgic readers? So we went with a new way of marketing, and that is, it's in select theaters across the country, but really, it's at home in your living rooms. You can watch it on any on-demand system. And I think that's going to be really how people see it. And what I learned, can I tell them what I learned? What I learned from the kids in Chicago in the two screenings yesterday was I have totally changed my mind about who can, should see this movie. I thought nobody under 12 should see this movie. And a lot of young kids came to the theater and I talked to them afterward. And I talked to one girl, I took her picture. She's turning 10 next week. And she said to me, the reason I needed to see this is what I learned from this movie is that if I can get through something like what Davy had to get through in this movie, if Davy could get through this, then she's going to be able to get through anything in her life. And that just totally, of course, moved me to tears. And I, in talking to a lot of parents and grandparents who brought young kids, I'm talking 8 and up, to this movie, it is for them, and it is a family movie, and it is good to see it with your kids and be ready to talk to them about it, but they can see this movie. I was going to restrict it. You know, I was afraid that if they saw it, because pictures are tough to see sometimes, and there's only one picture in it that's really tough to see, the father who is dying. But there's a lot of emotion there, and those young kids can handle the emotion. So yes, it's only playing here in Rosemont. I went last night. There was a very small audience. Thanks to one of my friends, it was a lot bigger than it would have been. And people you know, I'd love them to see it on the big screen. That is a gorgeous screen to see it on. And it's a beautiful movie because it's full of the scenery of northern New Mexico, the canyons, the caves, the mountains. And Davy's face is so expressive. And to be able to see that face up close on a huge screen, there's nothing like that. But it's a small movie. It's a very intimate. It's like Larry wanted to make it feel like a first-person book. So it's very intimate. It's all from her point of view. And it's lovely, I think, and I hope that you'll think so too. But see it at home. If you can't get to Rosemont, just see it at home. And see it with your family. Less expensive too.
We've only got time for a couple of really, really, really quick questions. Hopefully it'll be yes or no answer.
Hopefully I'll give shorter answers.
I was wondering in Tales of Fourth Grade Nothing, what gave you the idea to make Fudge swallow the turtle? I mean, I know you said you basically...
I can't understand.
Hang on just a second. I heard the first part. In Tales of a Fourth Grade Nothing, what was the rest of it?
Why did you make Fudge swallow the turtle?
Did you make Fudge swallow the turtle?
Oh.
Best question of the day.
Okay, because when I was starting to write, I read a newspaper story about a real toddler who swallowed a real tiny little turtle. And I wrote a picture book called Peter Fudge and Dribble that was never published about a little toddler who swallowed a turtle. And I got a lot of great rejection letters. This is very funny, but this will teach small children to swallow turtles. Or this is very funny, but it could never happen.
Yeah.
A lot of good rejection letters. But then I met Anne Durrell, a wonderful editor who took me to lunch. It was so exciting. And she said, how would you like to turn this story, the last, you know, the picture book, how would you like to turn it into a long book with chapters? And that could be the last chapter. I had never thought of doing that. Oh. And that's how I came to write Tales of a Fourth Grade Nothing. And that's why Fudge swallowed the turtle. But don't try it or I'll get in big trouble.
She will. I told you it was the best question of the day. One more tiny, tiny, really quick one, and then we have to go. And Judy's going to leave for a moment if you'll stay in your seats once we're finished, and then she's going to come back and be signing books for you. So just stay in your seats, but let's do one more really quick question.
How long have you been writing books for?
How long have I been writing books? Well, let's see. Somebody's going to have to do the math here. My first book was published in 1969. Thank you, George. 44 years ago, I know I was in my 20s, and I know I'm 75 now. So 44 years, it feels like yesterday to me.
Very good. Well, again, stay in your seats, and then Judy will be, the line will be forming for her to sign your books. But thank you all very much, and thanks most
thank
of all.
Thank you so Judy much. Good. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you. Thank you, guys. You're so sweet. I love you all. Thank you very, very much. Thank you. I have to stand up and clap for you. Thank you. Thank you so very much. I really, really appreciate this. Thank you.
Thank you for attending this program. Judy Blume's books will be sold right out in the rotunda outside of this room. And she will be signing. So if you have any books, just stay in your seats, and they will be helping you soon. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I have instructions regarding the upcoming book signing. We will be starting the signing in a few minutes. If you haven't bought a book yet, you can still do so out in the lobby. We will be calling you by the numbers that are on those yellow tickets you were provided when you entered. We will begin with numbers 1 through 25. You will line up to your right, to the right of the table. You are limited to 2 books per person.